basically this particular reflector trans used as basically used for the generation of the oscillations. So these particular reflector trans will operate in the different modes, and in the different modes it produces different oscillations. Okay, and as I already told you that the electrons will move and they will repel back from the repeller. So the electrons should return after 1/3-4th of the time, 2/3-4th of the time, and 3/3-4th of the time cycles for most optimum departure times. Now, as I already told you that this cavity is having a certain resonant frequency. If you ignore that particular frequency, you are getting the time. Okay? If t is the time for a period of the resonant frequency, f is equal to 1 by t or t is equal to 1 by f, you can call. If t is the resonant frequency of the cavity, and small t0 is the time taken by the free reference electrons to travel in the repeller space between entering the repeller space and returning to the cavity at a positive peak voltages. That means T0 is the time taken by a reference electron. So reference electron is the one which doesn't come across either a positive potential or the negative potential, a neutral potential. That is the time taken by this particular reflector electrons to move from the grid space to the repeller and from repeller back to the grid space. Okay, so that time is T0. So then the T0 can be calculated from the equation n plus 3 by 4 into T. Okay, so then this you can call it as n into T, where n, that is n plus 3 by 4, I can call it as an n. And this whatever the n is there, we can take it as 0, 1, 2, and 3. Okay, once again I am repeating. So this particular reflector oscillators will produce the oscillations, and these oscillations are produced in the different modes, and the different modes are generated depending upon how much amount of the time this reference electrons will take to return back. So the this reflector oscillators generate the oscillations in the different modes. That is, the different modes are depending upon how much amount of the time, so this reference electrons, that is T0, will take to repel back from this particular repeller. Okay? So the T0 is calculated by n plus 3 by 4 into T, where T is the time frame of the resonant frequency of the cavities. Okay? And now, so where this n, what you are saying is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, like this, and whatever the n you are specifying, if I take n equal to 0, that is 0th mode, n equal to 1, first mode, second mode. That means depending upon the values of the n, so the modes are called as 0th mode, first mode, second mode, and the third mode of the oscillations. Okay? Then the mode of oscillations are named as 3/4th mode, 1/3 mode, and 2/3 mode, etc. Now, as I told you that, so this particular reflectorstan operates on the principle of velocity modulations. Okay, the velocity modulation is nothing but the electrons which are moving from cathode to the repeller plates. When they pass through this particular gap, so this particular velocity gets changes because depending upon the potentials. So therefore, so it is called as a velocity modulations. Now, for the velocity modulations, we are consider. Now let us consider the electronic velocity u attained due to the DC B voltage V0. Because in the grid space, okay, now the cavity grid, we are applying a certain potentials. Because the electrons which are moving when move from cathode and before hitting to the cavity grid, so they are moving at its normal velocity. But when they pass through this particular grid, because of the application of this particular grid voltage, so their velocity gets changes. So the velocity of the electrons when it is moving through the grid, okay, remember when it is moving through the grid, it is defined as calculated from u equal to u0. It is equal to root of 2EV0 divided by m. Here, V0 is the voltage what it is applied to the cavity grid. Okay? And m is the mass of the electrons, and E is the charge of the electrons. Okay? So these values, if you substitute, I am going to get the values at 5.93 into 10 to the prime into root of U0 meters per second. That means to say that the electrons which are emitted from the cathode, when they are moving through the grid, okay, so they are moving with these particular velocities. Okay? And the instantaneous cavity RF voltage at an instant of the time, V of t is equal to V1 of sine omega t. That means at the cavity grid voltage, at any instant of the time, so it is calculated from the equation V1 sine omega t. Okay. Now, the another parameter you are supposed to calculate, one is the average transit time through the cavity gap, D, and the transit angles. So that means that depending upon the potentials, whether the positive potential is present or the negative is present or the neutral potential is present, the velocity, the time taken by the electrons to move through the cavity grid changes, because at the negative potential, the time required is more. For the positive potential, the time required is less, and for the neutral, nothing will be there. But on an average, we are supposed to calculate. Then, so those particular things can be calculated from, so D divided by U0, and angle will be omega into Tg. And what are the D parameters, what it has been shown? So the D is the distance between cavity grid, okay, and your plate. Okay. And so you have to calculate the average voltage in the cavity gap. So the average voltage in the cavity gap will be calculated from the equation V1 sin square theta g by 2 divided by theta g by 2, or you can this equation can also be voltage can also be calculated from V1 beta 1 sin of theta g by 2, where beta 1, what it is written, okay, so it is called as beam coupling coefficient of the cavity gap. That is, beta 1 is called as a beam coupling coefficient of the cavity gap. Okay, now just recall your memory, because you are having the cathode, in between that you are having the cavity grid, okay, and after that you are having a repeller plates. Okay, now before entering to the cavity grid, the electrons are having some velocity. In the cavity grid, the electrons are having the certain velocity, and these electrons exit coming out of this particular grid. So then they are also having the same velocities. That is the exit velocity. That means when the electrons moving out of this particular cavity, so whatever the velocity we are having, so that we are calling it as an exit velocity. So the exit velocity of the electrons from the cavity gap after the velocity modulation, because the velocity, remember, the velocity modulation takes place in the cavity grid. Okay, when the velocity modulation takes place, automatically the velocity of the electrons will get changed. So that velocity will be calculated from, so this particular equations. Okay, and this beta 1 V1 divided by V0 in this particular equation, it is called as a depth of modulations. And also, if the depth of the modulation is small, if the depth of the modulation is less than 1, then the velocity modulation becomes, if velocity modulation becomes less, and you can calculate the velocity. That means that if the depth of a modulation is greater than 1, so then this equation used to calculate the velocity of the electrons. If the depth of the modulation is less than 1, so then this equation we are using it to calculate the velocity of the electrons. Okay, so these are the equations you are supposed to remember to calculate the velocity of the electrons depending upon the depth of the modulations. Okay, the one more parameter we are supposed to calculate, that is the transit time. So what is this particular time is nothing but the electrons are moving out of this particular cavity gate, move toward the repeller space. From the repeller space, once again they are coming back. Okay, so this we are calling it as a transit time. That is, then from the transit time we are calculate the round trip time in the repeller space. Round trip time in the repeller space is calculated by 2 into velocity divided by accelerations. So in this particular equation, in the numerator, the 2 is used because the 2 is used because the electrons have to move first, okay, forward, and they have to return back. Because they have to move and they have to return it back, this 2 and fro motions are there. So therefore, here in the numerator, we are using the value 2. So therefore, the time, this transit time, can be calculated from that equation 2 u of Tg divided by A. So that is, so this particular equation we are using to calculate the round trip time. Okay, in this particular, V0 is the voltage what you are applying to the grid cavity grid, and whatever the Vr is there, so whatever the voltage Vr you are applying it to the repeller space. Okay, remember, so this particular equation, if you closely observe, so the TR term, so depending upon V0 and VR, okay, either you increase V0, any one of the V0 or VR, or you increase both, or you can decrease both, okay, so this transit time will be get affected. Okay, increasing or decreasing the V0 and VR will have an effect on the TR. Okay, next. Since the reference electrons, because as you know, the reference electrons is not coming across any of the potentials, that is the positive and negative. Since the reference electrons doesn't undergo any velocity modulations, it transit time in the repeller space. Okay, now that means that transit time for the electrons which are coming across the positive field and the negative field is different, and the transit time for the reference electron is different, and the transit time for the reference electrons will be calculated from this particular equations. Okay, now once after the velocity modulations, what happens is the electrons are bunched together, and these bunched electrons will move toward the repeller space. Okay, so this one we are calling it as a density modulations. Okay, remember two things: velocity modulation will occur in the grid space, whereas the density modulation will occur between the grid space and the repeller space. Because after the grid space, the electrons move in the bunches. Of the bunched electrons will move, so that here the velocity modulation occurs. Okay, now the time of arrival of the electrons to a cavity gap can be, after the density modulations, how much amount of the time these electrons will take to move from cavity grid to the repeller will be calculated from this particular equations. So that is TB is equal to either from this equation you can calculate, or from this particular you can calculate. So the arrival time of these bunched electrons, where this x is there, x is equal to pi n beta 1 to v1 by b. Okay, what are this particular x is there? Okay, so you can calculate it from pi into n into beta 1 into v1 divided by v. Okay, so this beta 1 is a coupling coefficients. Okay, and then so bunched electrons on return constitute the beam current. Okay, the bunched electrons move toward the repeller space, repeller electrodes, and they will return. When they will return, so whatever the energy they got when they are moving on the return path, they will give that particular energy back to this particular cavity gap. So on that time the current occurs, current is generated. That current is given by IB equal to I naught into 1 plus x cos of omega tg minus theta tg by 2. Okay, so this is the basic equations which you are using to calculate the beam current. Now, since value of V1 is less than V0, the value of x is less than 1 and TP is equal to T, then so this equation, okay, you can simplify it, okay, so that the beam current of a reflector oscillator is, okay, this is the general equations. Okay, here we are not at all going to deal with any of the derivation of that particular equations. We are only supposed to remember these particular equations. I basic equation used to calculate the IB is this, but because x and v1 values are very, very less, so therefore, we are using this particular equations to calculate the beam current. Okay, then, so one more current we are supposed to calculate, that is the fundamental component of the RSD induced current in the cavities. That is IRF is calculated from this particular equation, or IRF you can also calculate it from this particular. Either you calculate from this equation or you can calculate it from these equations. So from both the equations you are going to get the same values. Okay, then we are supposed to calculate the next parameters, that is power output. Okay, so the magnitude of the RF current in the cavity gap, that is to calculate the power output. As you know, power can be calculated from the basic electrical equations, electrical engineering equation. P is equal to V into I, or you can calculate it from I square R, or you can calculate it from V square power. Okay, so for the in order to calculate this particular power, we need to calculate the voltage and the currents. So the RF current will be calculated from this particular equations. Okay, then the RF power delivered to the cavity, okay, will be calculated from this particular equations. Okay, these are the some of the equations which are used to calculate the RMS, that is root mean square's power delivered to the cavity. Okay, so then we are supposed to calculate the next parameter, that is the efficiency. So in order to calculate the efficiency, we are supposed to calculate the DC powers. So the DC power supplied by the beam voltage is V0 into I0. And therefore, the reference electron efficiency of the reflector crystal oscillators can be calculated from PRF divided by PDC. So it is X is equal to J1 of X divided by pi n, where the values of X is calculated from this equation, and n will be n plus 3 by 4. And beta 1 will be sine of theta g divided by 2 divided by theta g by 2, and u is equal to root of 2e into V0 divided by m. So using these particular equations, we can calculate so the RF power generated from this particular device, and also we can calculate the efficiency. Okay, and now so from the Bessel's function tables, okay, now we'll go back once again. So in this particular case, okay, here we are using one particular term, x into J1 of x. Okay, now this particular J1 of x will be taken from the Bessel's tables, Bessel's function tables. So now this particular function table is same as, okay, just a comparison I'm telling you, that is a logarithmic tables, log tables. So that is J1 of x value, we are taking it from the Bessel's functions, and x is a parameter which is also related to this particular Bessel's functions, and a particular value of x, a particular J1 of x value is taken, and from those particular values, we are calculating the efficiency and the power output. Okay, now efficiency. How can you calculate efficiency? Efficiency is calculated from the Bessel's function tables. Okay, in the previous slide, we have x into J1 x term. X into J1 of x term. So this particular term attains a maximum value when this particular value of x is 1.52. Value of 1.52 at x is equal to 2.0 farad. That is, x into J1 of x attains a maximum value of 1.52 at x equal to 2.048. That is, when the value of this x is 2.048, so then this particular whole term will give you a maximum value. Thus, the optimum values are PRF equal to 0.3986 I0 into V0 divided by N. Then efficiency you can calculate is 0.3986 divided by N. Okay. Next is that, as you know, this reflector crystal oscillators operate in the different modes depending upon the values of the N. 1 into 3 by 4. 2 into 3 by 4, 3 into 3 by 4, like this, the different modes are there. It is observed that it is not possible to get the 3 by 4th mode in the, theoretically 3/4th mode will be present, but practically 3 by 4 mode is not possible. So therefore, theoretically we are using the 3 by 4 mode, but practical applications, 3 by 4 model is neglected. Only 3 by 4 model onwards we are considering. Therefore, 1 3 by 4 mode leads a maximum output and efficiency. Okay, so this particular mode will give the maximum output. So the maximum output, what you are getting it as 0.227 into V0 into I0, and maximum efficiency from this one you are getting it as 22.7%. That means to say that this reflector crystal oscillator, so the maximum efficiency will be 22.7. Okay, now this is the diagram showing you that how the output power, okay, generated from this particular device varies. So let us look into this particular diagram. Okay, so the top figure, A part A, is indicating that how the power generated from the reflex electron changes, and the part B will show you that how the frequency will get changes. If you closely look into this, for the 0th mode, when n equal to 0, we are having a peak power of 20 milliwatts. When n equal to 1, so the mode will be, when equal to 1 mode, the power decreases. And when n equal to 2, so once again, the power decreases. So that means to say that when you are moving from mode 0, mode 1, mode 2, mode 3, mode 4, like this, power goes on decreases. Okay? And if you want to have a lower power, use this particular device in the higher modes. If you want to use a more power, use this particular device in the lower modes. Second case is that if you observe this particular frequency thing is considered. Now, when you have a maximum power, so observe it here. Okay, maximum power you are getting for the lower modes, but here the frequency is very less, and here the frequency is more, and here the frequency is more. Okay, now with these particular graphs, you can observe it here is that if you get more power but less frequency, or less power and the more frequencies. Observe here, you are getting the more power for the zeroth mode, but the frequency generated is very less. And here, you are getting the less power and your frequency generated will be more. That means to say that low power modes will generate the high powers, lower modes will generate the high powers and low frequencies, and higher modes will generate low power and more frequencies. And depending upon the applications, which parameter you want, whether you want a more frequency or the less frequency or the more power or the less power, we are supposed to operate the devices in that particular mode. Okay, now, so this is the equivalent circuit of reflex crystal oscillators. So this GC is a cavity loss conductance. Here you are having the two parameters. One is the GC and the other one is the GLs. So GT is the cavity loss conductance, okay? And GL is the cavity loss inductance. And C is the capacitance, okay? And G and B, so what is there? So these are called as admittances, okay? That is the equivalent, to draw the equivalent circuit of a reflector trans. So it is represented in terms of admittance and the loss conductance and loss inductance. Okay. Now, as in the previous diagram, figures, we come across this admittance. So look into these particular diagrams, okay? When you look into this particular diagram, this diagram is explaining, so whatever the output power generated and the frequency generated, I have shown in the previous slides. Now, if you closely look into this, I am starting from this one. So, I can move in this particular clockwise directions. Okay. Closely, if you look into this, and also if you observe it here increasing N and here increasing VR. Now, as you know, the oscillation generated will be N plus 3 by 4. Okay, so from this equation, we are getting the different modes. Okay, now, so when this particular n equal to 0, okay, now I am being here. Now, when that is 0th mode, when n equal to 1, I am having this particular, n equal to 2 like this, that is mean to say that at this particular point, my mode is 0. Okay, and as you are moving in this particular directions, okay, as I am moving in this particular direction, observe this particular, my modes are getting changing. How these particular modes are getting changing, we have to consider with respect to this increasing N and increasing VR. Okay, if I am go on increasing N in this equation, okay, if I go, if my N equal to 0, my mode is only 3 by 4. Okay, if my n equal to 1, my mode is 1, 3 by 4. N equal to 2, 2, 3 by 4. Observe it here. Now, as I'm go on increasing this n, because observe here, when I'm moving like this, I'm increasing the value of n. By increasing the value of n, we are going to get the different modes. And increasing the value of the n, I'm going to get the different n's. And the different modes I'm getting, when you're increasing the mode values, then the power getting decreases, okay? For the lower modes, the power is high, but the upper mode, the power is less. But the frequency will be, for the lower mode, the frequency will be less. Okay, for the higher modes, the frequency will be more. Now, coming to the increasing VR. Now, so the increasing VR, it is now in the opposite direction, it is in the anti-clockwise. Remember, increasing the repeller voltage is opposite to the increasing N. Now, increasing n means, now I'm starting from this one, so I'm going like this. Okay? That means to say that if I'm go on increasing the voltages, I'm going toward the lower mode. That means to say that if my voltage applied to this particular repeller, okay, is more, okay, increase, I'm increasing because, so this direction, a little bit you are getting confusion with this particular diagram. Sir, you are telling increasing, but you are moving in this particular direction, okay, because the anti-clockwise movement will be there. I am go on increasing the values, because when I am go on increasing the values, you closely observe it here, I am going to the lower mode. Agree? And when I'm going to the lower mode, but the lower mode is going to give the higher output. Okay? So that means if I want to get the higher output, I have to go for the lower mode. When I have to go for the lower mode, then I have to increase the VR. When you increase the VR, okay, let us see what happens. Okay, I'll go back to the previous slide. Now, so this is the VR voltage what you are having. If you increase the VR voltage, what happens here? So this here, the negativity goes on increases because, the negativity goes on increases. When the negativity goes on increases, because electrons are moving, when the electrons move, negative potential here is, the electrons are opposed by a negatively charged particles, so they will come back. Now, depending upon how much amount of the negativity is there, more negativity will be there, more repelling force will be there. When the more repelling force will be there, with the more velocity, so the electrons are coming back. Okay, with the more velocity, the electrons are coming back, so therefore here the power output will be more. But here, in case of higher order modes, what is happening is that negativity will be less, the electrons are coming with a slower velocity. When they are coming with a slower velocity, okay, the energy transferred by these particular electrons will be very less. Okay, just I will repeat once again here. When the negativity at this particular point is very less, the electrons will repel with a very little energy. And when they are moving very slowly, when they will move slowly, whatever the energy they are having, they will transfer back to this particular cavity. The energy transferred will be very less, so therefore the power will be very less. But when the more negative voltage will be, VR will be there, so then the electrons move with higher velocity, so that it will transfer the maximum amount of the energy, so therefore the maximum power will be generated from this particular tube. Okay? Okay, so this is how by increasing the VR, we are moving toward the lower order modes. So that is now, so with this particular diagram, what actually this admittance diagram is showing is that by increasing N, you can move from lower mode, lower order mode to the higher order mode. But by increasing VR, you are moving from higher order mode to the lower order modes. Okay, so this is all about this reflex crystal oscillators.